I am Philip Clark from the board of the Rainbow History Project, and welcome, darlings, to the gay milieu. Many people remember that being the way that Bruce Pennington, a member of the Gay Liberation Front DC and a co-founder of the Rainbow History Project, would greet visitors to GLF's communal house at 1620 S Street Northwest. But while this seems an appropriate way to greet you at the beginning of Capital Pride Weekend 2014, we've chosen a different saying from the era, gay power to gay people, as the title for today's panel discussion and associated exhibit of materials about the DC Gay Liberation Front. It was this phrase, gay power to gay people, that Michael Yar, one of our panelists today, used in a letter to the editor in the June 9th through June 19th, 1970 issue of the underground newspaper, The Quicksilver Times. This letter, protesting the paper's derogatory use of the word sucks in a headline, also called for the founding of the DC version of the Gay Liberation Front. 2014 marks the 45th anniversary of Gay Liberation Front's beginnings. First formed in the wake of the Stonewall riots of June 1969 as an offshoot of the homophile group, the Mattachine Society of New York, the Gay Liberation Front was a revolutionary organization dedicated to overthrowing a sexist, racist, capitalistic society by joining in coalition with other oppressed social groups, such as women, African Americans, the working classes, Chicanos and Latinos, and American Indians. It also asked participants to engage in self-examination, often facilitated in the form of consciousness-raising groups, to rid themselves of their own internalized self-hatred, sexism, racism, and classism. Numerous Gay Liberation Front groups were formed in cities large and small before Washington, D.C.'s had its first meeting on June 30th, 1970 at Grace Episcopal Church in Georgetown. The D.C. Gay Liberation Front would go on to participate in a variety of political actions, protests, marches, publications, and social events, many of which will be discussed today. Participants in the group would be instrumental in creating some of the most beloved and important community institutions in Washington, D.C. These include both Gay Pride Week and Black Gay Pride, the Washington Blade newspaper, the Gay Men's VD Clinic, later renamed the Whitman Walker Clinic, the Friends Radio program that ran from 1973 to 1982, Black and White Men Together, and the Gay People's Alliance at George Washington University, to name just a select few. Despite this, the activities and contributions of the Gay Liberation Front DC have gone almost entirely unremarked in histories of gay radicalism. From Don Teal's seminal The Gay Militants, published in 1971, to Tommy Avokolimeka's vibrant 2009 anthology, Smash the Church, Smash the State, The Early Years of Gay Liberation, Gay Liberation Front DC has received only the scantest passing reference. And in general histories of the LGBT equality movement, there has been no mention at all. It is time to bridge this gap in the historical record. It is with that in mind that the Rainbow History Project is so very pleased to combine forces with our archival partner, the Historical Society of Washington, D.C., to bring together today four members of the Gay Liberation Front D.C., Brian Miller, Nancy Tucker, Michael Yar, and Kent Jarrett. Other members of the group were not able to be with us today, but I would be remiss if I did not thank Michael Ferry and also Warren Blumenfeld, who spent a good deal of time helping me with various ways in preparing today's event. I also need to thank Joel Martin, who attended early GLF DC meetings and was also a leader in the Gay Activist Alliance. He came to Rainbow History Project with the idea for today's panel, and his financial assistance helped to make it a reality. Finally, may I ask anybody in the audience who participated in any way in Gay Liberation Front DC or in any city's Gay Liberation Front to raise their hands? Please come say hello after the panel, and as you all can see, we have more revolutionaries in the room than just the four who are up on stage. Yeah. So without further ado, let's begin. Each of our four panelists will start by giving an opening talk that lays the groundwork and provides context for the group discussion that will follow. After that, we will open up the audience for questions and comments. So our first speaker will be Brian Miller. Brian Miller has been living in Washington, D.C. since 1969. He attended a few of the early Gay Liberation Front meetings, but became more interested in the activities surrounding the GLF House and the Skyline Collective, an offshoot group. He lived for a few months at Skyline. In the 1990s, he began researching the history of GLF DC and has interviewed a number of people who were active in it. He retired in January after several years as manager of editorial copy at AARP. Most of his career has been in journalism, much of it at Time Life Books and Music in Alexandria, the Library of Congress-affiliated Civilization magazine, and the Washington Post. Ladies and gentlemen, Brian Miller.
I hope you can hear me. My voice is giving out. But I wanted to first thank all the people who shared memories, materials with me for the research I've been doing for so long. So, and also I wanted to thank Steve Behrens, who's sitting in the blue shirt over there. He's been pushing me gently toward creating a website, which is now available for viewing at glf-dc.org. Okay, so we encourage you to go there and check it out. So, anyway, he's also been doing a lot of research into photographic material, so it's worth a look even for that, because there's stuff there that I didn't know existed. Anyway, the brief tumultuous existence of Gay Liberation Front DC began in 1970. Overlapping the civil rights activism of the Madison Society and the Gay Activists Alliance, and fueled by the spirit of Stonewall and the counterculture, GLF argued, acted, and offended. The 75 or more attendees at the first GLF meeting on June 30, 1970, at Grace Episcopal Church in Georgetown were mostly young, white, blue-jeaned men, with women and African Americans participating in smaller numbers. GLF believed that gay people were oppressed, had lived a lifetime of social, institutional, and personal oppression, much of it internalized, and needed to break free of all that. When people learned of their oppression, they got mad. Another piece of amazing news to many men and women of that time was that loving someone of your own sex was good and beautiful. I'm sorry, I'm falling apart. So a mixture of anger and joy informed many early GLF meetings. There was a lot of work to do, and many in GLF thought, many in GLF thought one should start by looking inside oneself. To achieve self-knowledge and liberation, the group adopted the consciousness-raising tool used in women's liberation. In consciousness-raising groups, members discussed pressures to conform, coming out, gay bars, sex, anything that was on their minds. The hope was to overcome self-oppression. Then many believed one could start achieving liberation in the outside world. GLF also wanted to establish a sense of community, and it had the good fortune to set up its own commune that September in a large townhouse at 1620 S, as has been mentioned. GLF House would become GLF's informal headquarters, Grand Central Station, providing a social center, information center, housing for people coming to town for various political demonstrations, and housing for gay young people tossed out of their homes by parents. Then there were dances, picnics, parties, and 6,000 flyers handed out on DC streets asking, "Are you a homosexual?" The simplest way for many gays to act politically was by saying three short words. As GLF's David Akin said, the most radical thing we can say or do is to admit that we are gay. So coming out was an important step. Some radicals went further than that by kissing each other in public. And a few took to skag drag, in which men wore women's clothing in public without pretending they were women. A skag-drag look might involve a dress, makeup, and work boots, and a beard. The attempt was to destroy preconceptions about gender roles. Another goal was to educate straight people and GLF went directly to high school and college students to talk about the experience of being gay. Some people had very basic questions like, who plays the man when you are having sex? And if you are not happy, why don't you become straight? In this world of counterculture politics in 1970, there were likely as many GLF goals as there were people in the room. Even when people shared objectives, they often differed starkly on priorities and strategy. With liberals and radicals continually bumping heads, some wanted action now and had no use for introspection. Others felt personal work was a priority, a first step. Structurally, the group was meant to be as unbureaucratic as possible. It was an anti-organization with no membership roles. And meetings were contentious, with some people interested in expounding their political positions, others wanting mainly to share their emotions. It was madness, chaos, anarchy. Everyone had an opinion, and they were all wrong, and I was right. In this dysfunctional setting, not a great deal got decided in general meetings. GLF organized through caucuses and committees, which met and made plans to act, then reported back to the general meeting. In the midst of all this confusion came Frank Kameny. Kameny, the city's most accomplished gay rights crusader since the late 1950s, said he had high hopes for GLF as a tool. But Frank was often frustrated and disappointed by his unruly allies. He was focused on exactly what he wanted, and some people didn't want to listen. 45 years old at that time, dressed in a coat and tie, he was a commanding presence, his booming voice. And as I said, some people just basically said drop dead. And he was trying to run things. Still, Frank attended every GLF meeting. He also continued his activism with great success for decades after GLF ceased to exist. I think GLF benefited from Frank's surgically precise approach, and I think Frank adopted some of GLF's heated rhetoric. GLF had the chance to test its belief on the very night of the first meeting, and just a few blocks away. Stopping by the Georgetown Grill, a gay men's bar, after the meeting, two women were refused service. They were wearing slacks. The next day, a group of GLFers attempted to sit in at the grill, but the police arrived and told them to leave. GLF then took up the issue of bars' admissions policies, which were essentially gays discriminating against black gays, drag queens, and women. First with a friendly letter, and much later with pickets. Pickets first against the plus one, where negotiations ultimately ended with clearer admissions policies, and later at the brand new lost and found. I'm going to mention three incidents that I thought worth mentioning. On November 11, 1970, about 35 protesters zapped a conference on religion and the homosexual at Catholic University. Protesters interrupted a talk by John Cavanaugh, a theologian psychiatrist, who pushed the idea that gays are both sick and sinful. Seated in the lecture hall, the protesters waited until Cavanaugh was about 10 minutes into his talk, when someone shouted, "Bullshit." Some unnamed person. Kavanaugh held onto the podium with both hands as protesters grouped behind him, hugging, kissing, and holding hands. Someone grabbed his notes and tossed them into the air. One protester read a list of demands, including, "We hold the Catholic Church and the institution of psychiatry responsible for political crimes committed against homosexuals." Second incident. Later that month, police arrested a dozen GLFers, later called the DC 12, for trashing a restaurant they said had refused them service. On the night that ended at the Zephyr restaurant near Tenleytown, many activists had come to Washington, for the Black Panther-led Revolutionary People's Constitutional Convention. Elated at a sense of inclusion, gay delegates had danced and chanted at a November 28th evening rally at Malcolm X Park on 16th Street. It's now Meridian Hill again. Late that night, four of the activists stopped for food at the Zephyr. They sat down, two of the men were holding hands, and waited several minutes without being served. They finally asked the manager whether they were being ignored because one of them was black. Then whether it was because they were homosexuals. No answer. The four returned to American University, where they were staying, to tell their comrades about the affront. About 40 returned to the restaurant, strolling among the tables, declaring gay is good. Soon a brawl broke out. The restaurant's front windows ended up broken, and a bar employee was knocked unconscious. No injuries for the gay men. Police arrested 12 gay men. Their defense team included Renee Hanover, a 44-year-old Chicago lawyer who had been kicked out of law school for being a lesbian. Hanover did not know of any previous group trial of homosexuals, and she sensed a historic opportunity. She came up with the idea of challenging prospective jurors, what is called voir dire, where you question them, on grounds of homophobia. Hanover succeeded in making bigotry against gays for the first time a factor in choosing jurors. But by the end of January 1971, things did not look good for the defense. At the last minute, a waitress at the Zephyr, who was waiting to testify, told the U.S. attorney that restaurant's employee had been improperly brought to a lockup to identify those arrested before a formal lineup, which is when you're officially allowed to identify people. At that point, the charges were dropped, the case fell apart, and Hanover's historic case became only a footnote in legal journals. Nancy will talk about women in GLF. I wanted to mention another preoccupation at GLF meetings, which was how to attract more African Americans. In March 71, in an effort to get closer to the black community, meetings were moved from Georgetown to St. James Episcopal Church on Capitol Hill. On May 3rd, 1971, during May Day protests, gay activists zapped an American Psychiatric Association conference at Washington's Shoreham Hotel, mainly to protest the inclusion of homosexuality in the association's diagnostic and statistical manual of mental disorders. So it was a disease at that time, basically. The APA action was pulled off jointly by Mattachine, GLF, and the New Gay Activists Alliance, which planned the action. The plotters planned to interrupt APA's presentation of awards and speeches when the psychiatric group's entire leadership was on stage. At an arranged signal, dozens of protesters, many in varying degrees of drag, came shouting into the room and up to the podium. The psychiatrist sat in shocked silence or yelled with hostility. A few proceeded to beat protesters over the head with their gold medals. Frank Kameny seized the microphone and proceeded to denounce them. When someone pulled the plug on the mic, Kameny continued his tirade while the psychiatrist shook their fists at us and called us Nazis. Frank never needed a microphone. In December 1973, the APA announced that homosexuality would no longer be considered a mental disorder. So, on to the team. Just to end, while formal GLF meetings were discontinued in July 1971, the GLF commune carried on by holding regular meetings and starting its own Christian congregation and served the community until the end of 1973. GLF spun off a second collective house, the Skyline Faggots, which has its own history spanning 4 years. GLFers were involved in things as varied as fighting gay oppression in Cuba and founding what evolved into Whitman Walker Clinic. So I'll stop there, let someone else talk. Thank you.
Our next speaker will be Nancy Tucker, to my left. Nancy Tucker's first experience of the openly queer life came when she found a copy of a San Francisco newspaper called Cruise News and World Report in a newsstand at 15th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue in about 1965. From her reading, she learned of the existence of gay organizations, including the Mattachine Society of Washington. Once she turned 21, she joined the Mattachine Society of Washington and spent 2 years attending meetings. With other Mattachine members, she was in the final annual Reminder Day picket at Independence Hall in Philadelphia, as well as the first Christopher Street Gay Liberation March in New York City. That would have been in 1970. In 1969, Frank Kameny asked Nancy to be the female editor of a Mattachine newsletter. This publication, initially a one-sheet mimeograph, was the Gay Blade, now the Washington Blade. And Nancy gradually became its unpaid editor and publisher, expanding it over several years. As editor of the Blade, Nancy participated in the meetings of many organizations, including the Gay Liberation Front, when it started in D.C. in 1970. After leaving the Blade in 1973, Nancy moved her activist tendencies into the alcohol recovery field. In 1979, with the late Cade Ware, who had been a fellow member of GLF, she helped found what is now NALGAP, the National Association of Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, Transgender Addiction Professionals, and their allies. In 1985, she joined the board of directors of the Gay Women's Alternative, DC. She left the DC area in 1992 to move to San Francisco and has resided in Albuquerque since 2004. She and her partner, Lynn Menefee, have been together for 26 years, but are too old-fashioned to want to get married, even though it's legal in their state. All the way from Albuquerque.
All the way from Albuquerque,
Nancy Tucker.
Greetings, fellow grayheads and children that we never had but would have liked to have had. It's really wonderful to see all of you here today and to see so many young people. It brings me back an awful lot to those early GLF days, except you guys would have much longer hair and rather scraggly beards instead of neatly trimmed ones. I want to talk about one of the things that Philip mentioned, that I waited until I was 21 years old to join the Mattachine Society of Washington as a way of introducing how Mattachine was at that time through my eyes. I was the next to the youngest person in Mattachine at age 21. And the reason I had to wait until I was 21 is Mattachine's rules said you could not join the organization until you were of majority age. They were terribly afraid of police entrapment, of being accused of preying on children, preying on young people. And in order to join Mattachine, in addition, you had to prove that you were 21. And you had to submit to an interview. I submitted to the interview at the office, Mattachine office, and reliably demonstrated that I was of majority age and that I was gay. And then I was allowed to go to meetings. Some people have said over the years that Mattachine was an almost entirely male organization, and that was not the case. Some of my oldest friends date back, female friends, date back to those Mattachine years. By my recollection, when I sit where I, in my mind, where I usually sat at those meetings, and I count around the room, roughly a third of the membership of Mattachine that showed up to meetings were women. And they were very active women. And they were sometimes almost as loud as Frank Kameny. Definitely as opinionated as Frank Kameny. So they were rather raucous meetings. But they were very hidden meetings. They were held in an Episcopal church, always Episcopal churches it seems at that time, on Capitol Hill, in a sub-basement room that was behind the furnace room. To get there, you went down the stairs, you crossed the dirt floor of the furnace room into a back meeting room that had no windows. We were trapped like little mice down there, but Frank apparently felt it was secure from whatever kind of snooping the police department might be doing at these highly secretive meetings. when we did pickets, there were annual pickets at Independence Hall in Philadelphia that were attended by members of gay organizations from up and down the East Coast. So from New York to Washington, people appeared, and we all gathered in Philly, which is more or less in the middle. And in those days, and I do not have a copy of them, but I believe they are available somewhere, there were dress code rules. 4th of July, men were in business suits with ties and white shirts. Women were in dresses. We were allowed to not have to wear stockings, and sandals were okay, but we had to wear dresses or skirts. There were picket signs that were stenciled, not handwritten. We all marched around like this in a very tidy circle. Very tidy circle. And that was what it was like to be a gay liber, although we didn't use that term then. And I'm using the word gay a lot because that's how I came up and came out. We didn't have gay, lesbian, bisexual, transsexual, QQI, I think it is now. It was just gay. All of us were gay. And that's still the word I prefer for myself because I am old-fashioned. So the last of those Philadelphia pickets was the business suits, and so forth and so on. But it was held a week after Stonewall, just a week. And there was a marked difference between how it had been in 68 and how it was in 69. In 68, we were all very prim and proper. In 69, the New Yorkers started to bust out. There were two young women who wanted to hold hands in the picket line. And Frank Kameny almost had cardiac arrest. Right there on the spot. He was apoplectic. Because we were picketing to be seen as equals, as proper, as worthy of hire, because the emphasis was very much on employment. And who's going to hire two pretty young women holding hands? There was a guy at that picket. He was in a business suit, I remember. But he carried a little tiny American flag, you know, one of the ones on the stick that's only about this big, and the flag is about like this. And he minced all around the line. And I'm sure Kameny somewhere was putting the back of his hand to his forehead at that. There were just little incidents like that, people beginning to break loose. And it was, for the most part, younger people. There was the group of people who were in their early 20s, and then there were the group of people in their later 20s up into Frank, probably among the elders at 40-something. So that was the last Independence Day picket. The next year was the first gay pride march in New York City. And we went from business suits to bell bottoms and beads. Although I think Frank did wear a business suit to that first gay lib parade too. But the difference was insane. I mean, New York was a mob of queers in all kinds of dress, in all kinds of colors, in all kinds of bell bottoms and beads. There's a slide up here that shows some of the guys with the flowers because it was flower power time. And it was so different than the properness of the homophile movement. It was raucous, it was kissing, it was, you know, just all kinds of demonstrations. It was screaming out of the closet and into the streets. It was noisy. It was not at all proper. And out of this kind of movement came Gay Liberation Front. I mean, it was an exciting and terrifying time to be gay. It was exciting because there was the feeling in the air that there's a potential for change. It was terrifying because there's a potential for change. And it was also terrifying because this is a time when there were radical bombings. There were all kinds of rather fierce demonstrations. There were cries of kill the oppressors, whatever oppressor you happen to fixate on. So it was also very scary. those early GLF meetings, I went, I guess, for a year, 2 years, I don't know how long it was anymore, were chaotic. It was very far from the Roberts Rules of Order that we used at Mattachine. Essentially, almost nothing got done. It was fun, 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 fierce, 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 fun, 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 fun. Lots of declamations of intent or desire, but nothing got done. I know Frank was very frustrated. I was very frustrated. Initially, my recollection is that there were, and I checked the issue of the Blade where I wrote up that first meeting of GLF, and there were 40 to 50 of us. And again, roughly a third were women. Many of them I knew from Mattachine. Other women who came in had heard about the group, and it stabilized for a little while being a few meetings, I think, at about a third of the group. And then very gradually things declined. One of the reasons I believe that participation of women declined is that the guys usually referred to women as girls. It was men and girls, men and girls, men. Well, this is the early days of the Women's Liberation Front. You know, the women's movement was coalescing and really coming together at that same time to be, you know, over the age of 18 and be called a girl. And I can remember any number of times sitting in the meeting and the guys would be going, da, 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 and they would say, the girls, da. And I would say, women, da, 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 girls, women. That was my principal contribution to GLF. Not that it actually did any good. I finally got, the number of women continued to decline until I was the last woman in GLF who attended meetings. And I was never a real part of the women's movement. I didn't go to NOW, I didn't go to any of those other organizations, but I was infused by the thinking just from reading the newspaper and the spirit of the times and going to women's dances and this, that, and the other thing. And I finally had enough, and I didn't want to just slip out the door and say nothing. I wanted to put down on paper and read the paper at a meeting, telling about my frustration with what was going on. And the result was a paper called Fuck You, Brothers. And I wanted to say fuck you because we all said fuck you then, you know, it was this kind of thing, you know, da-da-da-da-da, fuck you, da-da-da-da, fuck you. So I wanted to say that, and I wanted to put brothers in quotes because we talked a lot about brothers and sisters, and yet I felt by the way the brothers were treating the women in the group, they were not really treating them as the sisters that they declaimed to be, that they wanted women to be. So I wrote this paper. If you're interested, you can read it there or read it online. And I went to a meeting on at the Capitol Hill site of the group. I read it, and then I left. And unfortunately, the paper got picked up by The Ladder, which was a lesbian magazine at the time. And the editor had her own ideas about what to do with it, and so she changed my piece to include her ideas, but ran it under my name. So if you're ever doing research, do not use The Ladder's version of it. Use the Rainbow History Society's version of it, because that's the authentic version of the paper. But the paper basically said that, you know, you guys proclaim equality for all, you proclaim that women are your sisters, and yet you talk about girls, you dress in skag drag, you talk about, oh honey, this, and miss thing that, all kinds of subtle ways of putting down women. And that's not nice. That's basically what it came down to. And you're not living up to your own ideals in doing this kind of thing. And so I was very disappointed. You know, I sort of believed the rhetoric for a while too. And I think that what GLF did for for Washington is it highlighted the stodginess of the old style. It highlighted the energy of the new style. And out of the two came GAA, which married the two, the organizational structure and the energy, to actually get some things done. It was an amazing time. It really was. I am horrified to realize that it was 45 years ago. But thank you very much.
You might call our next speaker the founder of GLFDC. Michael Yar was born in Washington, D.C., eventually graduating from Archbishop Carroll High School in Northeast D.C., followed by a brief stint at George Mason College, at that point George Mason College. He was in the Air Force from 1966 to 1970. After his dishonorable discharge, he went back to George Mason, where he became involved with the anti-Vietnam War movement, connecting with the Northern Virginia Resistance and living in their commune for a few months. Around this time, he attended a Black Panther convocation at Yale, went to his first gay liberation workshop, and came out publicly for the first time. He returned to Virginia and set about organizing the Gay Liberation Front DC with the support of his friends in Nova Resistance, who were running the Washington Peace Center out of the Friends Meeting House. He met his first partner at a GLF newcomers meeting and embarked for San Francisco. He was active in Bay Area gay liberation before later returning to DC, and he now lives in Boston. This is Michael Yar.
Hi, well, I guess my one claim to fame is that I wrote that letter, and I'll go a little bit about my background, my personal background. I was, you know, totally closeted in the Air Force and high school and college. And I remember when the Stonewall riots happened, I was stationed in Tripoli, Libya at Wheelis Air Base, and I was in the brig because I had gotten busted by Kent's father. You know, it's a little story. His father is an OSI, which is like the FBI of the, and I was busted just for dirty pipe, and I got a slap on the wrist, so I happened to be staying in the brig. And I heard on the radio, you know, that homosexuals are rioting. I was like, oh my God, that's me. I mean, I knew I was queer, but I, you know, and there were lots of other guys that knew I was queer too, but I was still in the closet. So anyway, I got out of the Air Force and I got involved in anti-war activities. I went in as a young American for Freedom, young Republican into the Air Force, and I came out as a, you know, radical anti-war, you know, semi-activist. You know, I went to demonstrations and stuff. And got involved with like the Northern Virginia Resistance, and you know, there was a teacher at George Mason, Jim Shea, which was just, he was just a great guy, and his family and a bunch of us lived together. And Jim was appointed the Washington Peace Center, the job of taking over the Washington Peace Center, which I participated in. And through the women's, you know, through the women's movement, encouragement, and the civil rights movement, and anti-war, you know, I just, you know, I said, well, how come I'm not free, you know, I'm not liberated, you know, so I started talking to a couple of people, you know, and they said, well, you know, you should try to do something. So I went to the conference in Yale, and it was kind of cool. It was Jean Genet was the keynote speaker.
Oh, wow.
And that was kind of impressive. And then I went to my first gay liberation. I snuck away from my friends at the, you know, that I had gone up with from Virginia, and I snuck to the gay workshop, you know, and then I was just so, you know, I met some people there, and it was just wonderful to stand up and say, I'm gay, you know, and I've never said that in public. I mean, I might have whispered that to a friend or something, but I never said, I'm gay. And it was quite empowering. And there were Gay Liberation Front people there, so I just kind of talked to them and went back to my friends, and I said, hey, I'm gay. You know, it's like, whoa. It was great. Came back to Washington, and and the Quicksilver Times, or Quicksilver Times,
yeah. Quicksilver Times.
That was our underground hippie newspaper, you know, and they wrote an article, and it said, Suharto sucks. You know, Suharto was the leading a coup in Indonesia, and they were against the coup, which they should have been because it was an awful thing. But anyway, they said Suharto sucks, which I didn't disagree with, but I mean, with what they were trying to say, but sucks. I mean, I knew what sucks was. It was a put down of, you know, of queer men, you know. That, what do queer men do? They suck cock, you know. It's like, so anyway, I used that, and I said, brothers and sisters, you know, we should get together, the gay liberation, you know, we should organize a gay liberation front. So, you know, my friends at the Washington Peace Center helped, and, you know, we had some meetings, and, you know, it slowly came together, and we got a meeting organized for, you know, Grace Church, and for June 30th, and around June 28th was the first gay liberation parade in New York City, and a bunch of us went up for that and participated in that, and I mean that was like maybe 100,000 queers, you know, people, you know, men and women and black and white, and it was just so fantastic. It was just so fantastic. It was, you know, just wonderful. So and I came back to Washington, and we got Gay Liberation Front started with meetings, and like Brian and Nancy have said, it was quite chaotic. You know, there was no real order, but I think our effect was, we didn't get laws passed or something, but we had an effect. You know, we affect the consciousness of especially our peers. You know, our young peers, hippies, and all kinds of things, but other people too, like the older gay establishment. Nancy was saying the Mattachines was affected by what we were doing, even though, you know, we were disorganized and anarchic. You know, in the sense that I love anarchy. You know, I mean, my wonderful senator, you know, Elizabeth Warren, you know, calls the Republicans anarchists, and I was like, oh man, don't do that. You know, I mean, anarchy is something that's deep, and if you could just use that kind of language, it's, you know, but anyway, politicians are politicians. No offense if it's anybody. Anyway, so like,
you're in D.C. now, Mike.
I know.
Careful.
I'm dressed for it, aren't I? Khakis and blue shirts. So anyway, we got it started, and, you know, like Brian said, I met my first partner at a gay liberation meeting, and then we escaped to San Francisco. After a couple of months, we escaped to San Francisco and lived happily ever after for about a year or two. And then we came back to Washington and did this and that, and, you know, Gay Liberation Front had just kind of, you know, waned, but there was the Gay GLF House, which, you know, which was very active and stuff. I guess that's about all I have to say. It's just, I feel very grateful that I could do that. And, you know, I like coming, I've lived all over the place, but I come back to Washington and I love it. I'm almost like, you know, almost like the Pope, I want to kiss the ground. And so I love Washington, and I just live someplace else. And thank you for being here.
Our last individual presenter is going to be Kent Jarrett. Kent Jarrett, along with his brother Stephen, was one of the founding members of Gay Liberation Front DC. He was an organizer of consciousness-raising groups during the early days of GLF. He was also a founding member of the Skyline Faggots Collective, whose house was down the street from the GLF house at 1620 S Street. During that time, he worked in the office of Ramsey Clark as a legal secretary during the Berrigan brothers' trial. He has also worked for the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, as well as News House News Bureau. He later became a social worker in New York City, working and consulting for several LGBT organizations, managing a private practice, and teaching clinical casework and counseling to graduate students at Hunter College, City University of New York. This is Kent Jarrett.
This is the largest consciousness-raising group that I've been able to attend, so thank you for coming. My mother always said that if you wanted to be liked, you should try to think of an amusing story to tell people. And so I thought I would start with, it actually was very serious, and I'll get into that in a minute, what we were trying to do with consciousness-raising groups. But I was not the person in charge, but was really doing a lot of work recruiting people to be in these consciousness-raising cells. And the first one that we had, what you could basically do is call me up and say you wanted to be assigned to a consciousness-raising cell, and you would get assigned. And much to my chagrin, the feeling of it was a little bit more like a Tupperware party, you know, in the beginning, and it was very hard to keep people on point, which was, you're fucking oppressed. I want, you know, we should be yelling about this. I don't want to hear about your Saturday night date. So it was pretty dour in some ways. And I used, we used the Red Stockings resistances to consciousness raising paper. They were a feminist group, radical feminist group in New York. And we really tried to use a lot of materials from the women's movement and from this radical group. So the first consciousness raising group that I attended, I was working for Newhouse Newspapers at the time as a copy boy. And I got people on the floor. It was amazing. I just walked down the hallway and found like the assistant for, who did he work for? Oh, the Boston Globe. Some other people on the floor that worked for some newspapers, and they all came. And so I kept them on point at the first meeting, and we really did talk about what it was like to actually be out there, to stop living in the shadows. I had dropped out of college because at one point I discovered I was on the fraternity hazing list. They were forced to call me up and ask for a blowjob. So this was very scary at a large university. And I left. So I wanted people to join me in this kind of discussion. And so we managed the first week. The second week, one of the participants who had come out for the first time to himself, not alone to the public, or to his friend, said, I had sex. So we were all excited about that, and I thought that was a revolutionary act. So we wanted to hear about it, you know, under the guise, of course, that this is really important for the whole group to process. So to try to wind this down, he had been cruising. I think it was around Dumbarton was the big cruising spot then. And he picked up a cop in full uniform and brought him home. And we kept going, and you were then arrested, and you were then arrested. No, they had a great time. And that was his first experience, and it came out of the consciousness raising group. But to think of just the kind of chutzpah to pick up a cop on the street in Dumbarton. It's amazing. The consciousness raising groups, I think, were really important to a lot of us because we all had been living in the shadows. Like I had been at college and then got outed in some horrible way and in a way that was really scary. To be able to talk to each other about those fears, to be able to talk about being out, how to come out, out of my consciousness raising group. I'm not that subtle in some ways. I actually went to the office, Newhouse Newspapers, Washington Bureau, and posted a poster on the wall, on the bulletin board, rather, that said, "Attention, I am gay, Kent Jarrett." And all the reporters were so sweet. they, you know, and totally perplexed. And they kind of like, and they were really old-fashioned cigar-chomping, you know, reporters, both the men and the women. And they would like come walking around and they'd go, oh, saw that poster. Is it intro? Yeah, that, yeah, great. But every one of them felt compelled to come in and talk to me about it. So those were some of the things that would happen, and you'd bring that back to your consciousness-raising cell and talk about how it felt and what was going on. The thing that I wanted also to really address is that, from my point of view, and again, it's hard to say that any of us were members, only because we attended, I guess. There is no membership list. There is no such thing as an official member. You just came and... On some level, it really was who could shout the loudest. Or you could come up with some plan. You know, I think that's how the plan came up for 6,000 flyers. And then you called on the consciousness cells to get together, hear some flyers, walk down the street, and hand them to a perfect stranger. And it says on it, are you a homosexual? And then explains what that is. So... I was very interested in the anti-war movement. My father, as Mike has already said, was in the military. Michael could have been thrown out for being gay by my father, but it was for something else. But that was also his mandate as an OSI officer, was to ferret homosexuals out of the service. So you can imagine being raised in that environment. It's kind of, in some ways, I had a very good relationship with my dad, but in some ways, it's a little bit kind of like a mafia family because, you know, when my mother, I didn't call my mother for like a month when I was in D.C. when I first came, and she had the police come to the Skyline Faggots Collective, which she didn't know about, looking for me to find out how I was. I was one of the activists that was out on the East Coast and in the closet in Ohio. And you can't do that today with the internet. But there were two reasons, certainly because of my father being one of the biggest ones. I also had a brother, a year older than I. We both joined GLF at the same time. We were at the Catholic Kavanaugh's demonstration. I never saw Stephen, who was a very shy guy. I couldn't believe seeing him jump up like that and run around the room, and I'm running around after him like the young brother. And it brought us really close together. We lived in the family as closeted with each other, and came out to each other and joined GLF, lived together. He died of AIDS in 1994. But I was very interested in inserting myself into any left movement or any left demonstration. So I thought I would tell you two or three examples. One, I went with a new boyfriend to a demonstration at the base in Baltimore. I don't know if the Berrigan brothers were involved with that, but the Friends Committee was up there, and that's where this new boyfriend was. And I thought, cool, I'm with this like Quaker, this is great. And we go up there, and we were caught, evidently, a spy holding hands. And we're called into a meeting with the elders. And he was very compliant. They said, you're going to give us a bad name. You know, we're for you. But no, we're not ready for this yet. People aren't ready for this, and it's going to give the Quakers a bad name. So I used the GLF lingo, bullshit. And my boyfriend stayed. And I intended to stay, no matter what. And when I got back to my tent, all of my possessions and my wallet were gone. And 5 minutes later, one of the elders came to me and said, we've heard there's been a theft. And we bought you a bus ticket. And they put me on a bus. So these were the kinds of things that would happen. and why it was important to be involved in these in so-called progressive groups and left groups. And not to mention, I lost this wonderful boyfriend over it. Another experience was going to a rally where Joan Baez was the biggest speaker. And by then, I was a Cub reporter in training at Newhouse. So I was there as a reporter. And she was talking about burning draft cards and not being drafted or not going for the draft. And she said, I know it's a scary proposition because you may be sent to jail and you're worried and a lot, and you would be worried that you would turn into a fag. Joan Baez. So, like the objective reporter that I was, I stood up and said, bullshit. How can you talk like that of all people? Don't you know that there's something called gay liberation and you need to be educated? And she actually sent one of her people to get me after the show and brought. I went backstage and she cried real tears and said, I can't believe I said that. I can't believe that I'm perpetuating this. Thank you so much for bringing to my attention. I had a girlfriend for several years. Oops, that's off the record. But still, came out to me and apologized. So it was kind of a happy ending. And of course, I didn't report it. It was off the record. She did come out as a bisexual, I guess, a couple of years later. But I was the first one she told. When I worked for Ramsey Clark, I did indeed dress in a skag drag to go to work. I thought it was very hippie-ish 40s. I would wear jeans and this nylon rayon print dress, and had a beard, and I actually had hair then. A lot of it, believe me. If there's anything you can take away from this program, I had a massive amount of hair. But here I am in the office of the former attorney general. And his assistants would come to the Skyline Faggots Collective at 1 a.m. often, and bring the tapes of all of the interrogatories and all the interviews they were doing for witnesses for the defense. And I would be up all night typing them up. And again, it was just a matter of, I felt, inserting myself in these groups. I mean, I was also being paid, that was my job. But people really, especially, you know, they had to deal with you, particularly when they were these leftist, progressive groups. They weren't thrilled, but they really had to deal with you, and I think a lot did get accomplished. The last one that I think I want to mention maybe is the American Psychiatric Action. Brian already mentioned it. I just wanted to say I got hit over the head with a high-heeled shoe repeatedly. So that was like the big, that was my big event. We were absolutely non-violent. We were definitely into being offensive and to do whatever it took, but we were very, very much into being non-violent. On May Day 1971, we were also told that they were not going to deal with gay issues, the big organizers. So we had Gay May Day.
Could you explain for a second, for people who don't know, what May Day was?
I don't know if I can explain it well. Jump in and explain it better, Michael. But it was, most of it was around anti-war. It was around the anti-Vietnam War protests, and it was happening on May Day.
May Day is the International Workers' Day. It's like Labor Day. So all over the world, they celebrate it, you know,
and
except here, of course.
And, right.
Of course.
We know what to do with workers.
So there were a lot of things, there were a lot of issues they were addressing. But they decided they weren't going to address gay issues. So we had to organize our own gay May Day. I don't know if you remember the columnist McGrory. What's her first name? I'm trying to remember. Mary. So Mary McGrory decided she wanted to go down there, but she didn't have any connections. And Newhouse said, "Well, we've got this cub reporter, and you can, you know, he'll take you." And she also brought people from the Boston Globe, because her cousin worked there. There were a whole team of reporters, so I was thrilled, and I took them straight to the encampment of the Gay May Day group, and they went straight the other direction, and I pulled them back. And basically, they all said, "Yeah, yeah, well, that's nice," right? And they just didn't want to talk about it. So all I could do that day was insert myself in between Lillian Hellman and Timothy Leary and grab their hands, and the three of us saying, "Give peace a chance," up in the thing. But that was really our goal. We did some very serious things going to the Black Panthers People's Constitutional Convention and participating there. One of the people in the skyline, Faggus, was a doctor who also helped provide medical care during that period for the Panthers. And it was just, we felt important to show up, whether they wanted us there or not. And they had to take us. We also, the last thing was, there's so much stuff. The Venceslao Ramos Brigade. Now that was groups of people that wanted to support the Cuban Revolution, and they went over and worked in the cane fields and met with Cubans and wanted to really be a part of that. And at the same time, the Cuban government was putting homosexuals in camps and imprisoning homosexuals as being diseased. It was pre-AIDS, just being diseased, period. Almost like being homosexual was a contagion. So a group of us found out there was a fundraiser in Georgetown for the Venceslao Ramos Brigade. And we all showed up. I think there were, who was there? Brian Reed? Mike, how many people?
I was there. I still have a pre-Columbian statue
of it. Billy Took, yeah. He had sticky fingers. There were about 30 people, 20 people.
Statue of limitations has run out by now.
20 or 30 people. Anyway, it's a nice size. And we knocked on the door, and they answered the door, and we said, "We're the homosexuals." And we came in and said, "We are going to educate you." And they were very nice about it, actually. They were a little, you know, shocked. But they listened, and we stood around the room, and we made our boisterous statements about what they were doing and why they shouldn't do it, and then left. And that was a nice event, actually. I'm sure I'm running out of time here, so there were a lot more events. But I want to say, in addition, looking back now at the age of 65, in youth is pleasure. And we had so much fun. And you could go to a meeting and shout at each other all night. And yes, practically nothing got accomplished. Except something happened to your spirit. Something made you feel strong. And then you usually had some great sex. In there, and it was the first time you met guys. We were, you know, 20 years old, 19 years old, 22 years old, whatever. It's hard to imagine what it's like to know that you don't have to go to a bathroom on the college campus. You don't have to go to the just at night to a cruising spot. You don't have to go to a bar. We had picnics at the Peace Street Beach, hung out. And again, it was always, in the early days, very shocking to other people that were there. And so you were constantly, just by being there, educating them. But educating yourself and having the spirit rise in you that made you feel human and alive. And I think that's the thing that I think about the most when I think about GLF. One night after a dance, I met three guys from Texas. I thought, fabulous, the guys from Texas. They're gay in Texas, too. I can't believe it. This is great. I brought one of them home with me. We had a great time, and then we were going to be picked up by their two friends to go to a party in Georgetown. And I found myself in a car with a gun to my head and being told that I was going to be shot and buried somewhere outside of D.C. And I knew they were serious when we started to get on the off of Rock Creek Park, when the guy that I had just been with started begging them not to do this again. So I threw myself out of a moving car on a ramp that was going about 20 miles an hour, and a bullet flew over my head. And when I got to the police climbing up a hill, I didn't know if I had been shot or not because my head was bleeding. I was not shot, but I did, either from the noise of the gun or from the head injury, I did become deaf in one ear. And also for 30 years had dizzy spells, et cetera, et cetera. So there were dangerous things that could still happen. 2 weeks later, friends and myself were walking. I think we'd been to the community bookstore, and a drunk came running out of a bar with a 2x4. And I threw myself in front of my comrades and held up my hand, stop it, and got my hand broken. So from that, I had a very rough time. To have two bashings like that and a near murder within a two-week period. And that's when I learned that therapy wasn't going to be helpful. What was helpful were the Skyline Faggots. We had our own consciousness-raising groups. We processed it. They took care of me. I had an encapsulated... I'm a therapist now, so... I had an encapsulated psychotic state for about a year, where I thought I was being poisoned by food. And when I went to a therapist, I really had to leave. It sounded like he was going to hospitalize me or worse. When I stayed with my comrades at the Skyline Faggots Collective, I was treated as somebody who was going through something and needed to have their hands. And it got to be not just wonderful, but it got to be amusing because they became like food tasters, right? So here are these people that I adore, but they're saying, okay, we're tasting the food and we'll give it 20 minutes and then you can see. And I'm thinking, they could die for me. I mean, I was in this state. They could die and they would do this for me for almost a year. And would we go to restaurants? When we got invited to dinners at other collectives, they would say, we're coming and Ken's coming with us and you can only fix this kind of food and we need to taste it before it goes on the table. And they cured me. So that's the kind of things that came out of GLF, both good, bad, murderous, and life-saving. There's so much more to tell you, but I just have to stop.
I wanted to start a little bit of a discussion sort of amongst the panelists as opposed to just the individual statements, but we want to leave plenty of time for questions from the audience as well, so why not go on for too long. One question I wanted to ask our panelists related to this idea of liberation, and what exactly did being liberated mean for members of Gay Liberation Front?
I think Ken expressed it best, in my opinion. It was just the feeling of empowerment and being a real person. You felt so repressed all your life that it made a huge difference.
And I know the connection of the group to the broader left movements that especially Mike and Kent discussed in their talks. Did you all feel welcomed as a gay person in the broader leftist movements of the time?
It depended on the group, as I was saying, but mostly you felt you were making them welcome you. They weren't, it was very unusual, like what the Friends did. It was very unusual for them to actually throw you out. But they definitely felt uncomfortable that you were there.
Well, we were changing our consciousness, and we were having to affect other people's consciousness.
Right.
Their consciousness was low, but ours was also low. But we freed ourselves as much as, that was our, that's what we were doing. But we had to affect those people, but we couldn't expect those people to have the same feelings that we had. So, it's like, those things were, terrible. And the Friends, they would never do that today, I think. But when we started the Gay Liberation Front, it was out of the Friends meeting house in Washington. So, I think that we were welcome, but we needed to, advance our agenda,
And, I wanted to get sort of a broader issue of what the significance might be of GLF and GLF's actions and form of consciousness today. It seems that nowadays GLF was superseded by Gay Activists Alliance and superseded by sort of more direct civil rights organizations, people working within the system rather than trying to change the system. Do you all see there as still being a place for GLF's ideals and tactics in today's world?
Well, I definitely do. I think the liberation, the emancipatory, needs have never been more, real, the way the world is today. Gay liberation was getting in touch with that freedom that, and looking at what the world is doing to us, the pressures of, not just as gay people, but as people, as, as workers or as women, as blacks, and, and that sharing in that the emancipation project is definitely, people get married, that's fine, we applauded Nancy when she said she was old-fashioned. She didn't want to get married, but there are a lot of people in the gay community that aren't equal rights kind of people. There's a new symbol I saw, that's queers against equality or something, and then it's a greater than symbol, And I forgot to bring. I have a few of them at home, but there's a need for liberation. Period. And I think as gay people, we have our own, take on that. So I think, there's definitely a need if there's any future.
It's hard to know if we can actually. I personally feel like I can have a little bit of effect that maybe comes from that spirit. What I'm disheartened by is the assimilation that's going on. That's really all more about branding. In some ways, and I've done a lot of consulting for LGBT groups. I'm not going to name names, but for example, I will say of 4 youth programs that I've consulted with around counseling issues, every program, and these are LGBTQ, et cetera, programs, have told their therapists on staff that they are not to disclose their sexual orientation to the young person. What? Bullshit. I think part of this comes from there are a lot of straight allies that are working at these agencies and feel uncomfortable with it about how to identify as straight to a gay person. And I think that's one of the effects. I think the other is funders and that they really have to present themselves, or they think they have to present themselves in suits and ties again. I don't know what the deal is. A lot of the agencies have executive directors making well over $250,000 a year. And their frontline workers are still making $30,000. So I think that calls for some kind of action. I'm so tired. But some kind of spirit has to get in there. I don't know how, but I mean, I think GLF could have some effect coming down there, just for people knowing what we did and knowing that you can make a ruckus on some level.
But I mean, it feels almost like we're back in the homophile movement again, the homophile era, in the sense of the tactics that are pursued.
It does feel like that.
I have a quote here from Edward Sagarin in 1970, who was describing the homophile group's activities and sort of mindset prior to Gay Liberation Front. And he said, quote, "If only society could be convinced that homosexuals were really good boys and good girls, not promiscuous, very loving, always law-abiding, excellent, forever the victim, never the victimizer, they would be accepted. They were loyal, excellent security risks, were no sissies and bull dykes, and would make good soldiers and sailors if only given the opportunity." And it almost feels like we've arrived, I mean, to me it feels almost like we may have arrived back at that moment in sort of the tactics that are being pursued.
The gay men's health crisis in New York is using GMHC more and more often without using the name spelled out. There was a whole discussion of changing the name to take gay out of it. That couldn't happen, so now they just use the initials. I was affiliated with a group called the Gay and Lesbian Affirmative Therapy Program, which was a fabulous program. Also trains straight therapists and allies about being sensitive to gay issues. They recently changed their name to the Gender and Sexuality Study Program. What the fuck is that? You know, and you know, suddenly you see gay being taken out in these very subtle ways, just removed. The last thing, I've been teaching grad school, I got fired for bringing a union grievance, Michael, against my the pay scale they were giving me. So now I've only got one job, but I was teaching in two different departments. One of my grad students went for an internship at an agency that was supposedly progressive, a counseling program, not LGBT oriented, but had a lot of LGBT therapists, and was asked point blank, he was a very effeminate man, and they asked him if he felt he could work with straight people. He didn't even know how insulting that was. All he knew was that he should probably butch up. This beautiful man. I tried to explain to him, I told him I would give him as his field advisor 100% backing to bring a complaint to the field office, and he refused to do so. And I have to just sit and watch this happen. But this is happening more and more and more, where also a certain type of gay person is privileged. You know, when you say at an agency you're not supposed to disclose your sexuality, as I was told in 1974 when I got my first college teaching job, they were allowed in 1974 to say to me, "We don't want our students knowing that you're gay." And I said, "Well, gee, they're college students, they're kind of smart. They're going to figure it out." But what they're really doing is privileging people who can, quote, pass. And effeminate men, butch women, are getting left out in these very direct ways by our own communities, by our own agencies.
It feels too like there are other, you know, elements that are under attack. I mean, GLF, part of its goal or its core mission was to align with other groups, to gather together with working class groups of African Americans, with women. And I think we certainly see, between the attack on unions in this country, lots of attacks on women's rights, reproductive health, in a variety of these ways, that it seems almost like things are backsliding. And I wonder whether we're doing enough in the gay movement to combine with other groups to try and make society fairer for all people. No comment.
Yeah, I agree we're not. We're not doing, but early gay liberation was really about consciousness raising and you know, was not really about, we did bond with other groups, you know, the anti-war women stuff, but our main core was establishing the gay consciousness, you know? And now everything just seems to have, I don't know. Well, you know, we know what's going on in the world, and people are, you know, not really protesting, you know? I mean, we're just really sheeple, and I think that's part of the gay movement as well as any other movement. The left or any kind of progressive forces are minimal, and, you know, the consciousness, you know, maybe it'll change, hopefully it'll change, but the degradation of the earth and the enslavement of people all over the world for our creature comforts, you know. Yeah, I mean, the gay movement should be a part of, you know, and I don't think it is now. I mean, like you said, the civil rights groups, they're for civil rights, you know, they pass this law, they pass that law, you know, they bribe this one, you know, I don't know. But it's not just the gay movement, all movements need to get together and just, you know, confront the powers that be, I think.
We've gotten very separate, and the police and the institutions have gotten very good about controlling, you know, demonstrations like we were used to actually just can't happen anymore. Occupy Wall Street, I thought was I thought that was kind of the same sort of spirit that we had with GLF. And I'm really heartened by what people can do with the internet. I mean, when you look at what Snowden did, this one person, to completely disrupt and expose some really awful stuff that's happening through a computer. So I've just learned how to handle my Microsoft program correctly, but the younger people can really do so much with the computer and can get hundreds of thousands of people to make some noise. And I'm hoping that something like that would happen. I'm from New York, work in New York. There's a gay community center in the Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens, Staten Island, and Manhattan. And again, it's wonderful teaching and being in the field because I know what's going on. One of my students organized a meeting with all of the middle management of each one of these centers, had a breakfast for them, got them all together as a community organizer to talk about how they could share resources. They had one meeting, and all of their bosses said, "You don't go to those meetings. They're all fighting for the same money. They don't talk to each other." I helped develop a suicide prevention protocol for our youth program. And another program called us up and said, can we see your protocol? And we put it in the mail, and the person who did it was called on the carpet and said, "They should be paying for that. You shouldn't be giving that to them." This is one gay community center to the other. A suicide protocol for youth. So I think part of the problem is the funding. Everything is so funding driven. I was looking at some of the newsletters, and it was a riot. I forget, there was some group we took a collection for, and it was $20. Now, that meant a lot, I suppose, in 1971, but still, that doesn't happen anymore. All the money is coming from the government or from corporations, and it divides people.
Or rich people.
And just plain old rich people. And it divides people. I mean, there's some good stuff that happens out of it, but people won't. I've done that more than once. I've gotten two agencies together. I took two directors of two youth programs out to lunch with my own hard-earned money and said, "You're sharing the same clients. They keep showing up at here and there and here. Why don't you do a transitioning thing with them and have some linkage?" They were very polite at lunch. I called them a month later. "So have you all gotten together again?" "No." And they never did. Because they're fighting for the same dollars. And that's what's really making it tough in terms of any linkages. And all these civil rights groups, they just work on their single issues now.
Yeah, Warren Blumenfeld, another GLFDC member, talks about the idea of capitalism co-opting revolution, of the necessity of making money and continuing to have money to run programs, which is the main goal. as opposed to creating the coalitions that you were talking about to try to better serve people who need those services.
And the economy is so much worse now than it was in the late 60s, early 70s. I mean, the amount of debt that college students have when they get out of school, I mean, that handicaps them. They can't live for a year or 2 years on almost no money at all, as people did back then. They can't do that. And we have to have, these days, two working adults in a family to support that family. Back then, it was often just one working adult. So that drives a lot of things, too, that prevents people from having the time and the energy to be able to organize.
Great point.
I made enough as a legal secretary to support a lot of people in the Skyline Collective. And if I wanted to go, and we just pooled our money, but if I wanted to go out to San Francisco to visit Michael or visit my brother who was living there, I would call first and get a temp job so I could pay for the fare, and I'd go out and work 3 days. And what I'm amazed is how much younger people are making on just these kinds of jobs now. They're making the same thing I made 40 years ago. I used to make $10 an hour as a proofreader, and I'm hearing about people making $10 an hour now. That's a great point, Nancy. There's just, people are struggling.
I want to open things up to the audience to see if there's anybody who has a question for any of our panelists, and it looks like there are. So when I know your name, I'll call on you by name, and if I don't know your name, I'll just point in your direction. Steve?
Yes, Nancy, I had I don't know if I should say pleasure, but reading the letter that you have in this quick case, everybody should read it. I mean, the hair on my back of my head's I can only imagine, you know, what the reaction was, but what none of your fellow panelists has addressed is what was the reaction? I mean, obviously, the group voted not long after that. Has anybody, did anyone ever apologize to you? If the group had continued, do you think it might have turned around?
No. I realize now that the room was filled with testosterone. And testosterone was the sex thing, but I think testosterone also clogs men's ears. You know, there's something that happens in the brain. And if I was in that situation today, I just would recognize what it is and say, okay, this is not for me. This is something different. I think that there was some shame there. And nodding of heads and gee, I'm sorry's, but it didn't change anything at all. And as you say, that the group broke up shortly thereafter. And you know, just looking at the pictures, you can see there are no women in these pictures. There were women in GLF, but there are no women in the pictures that are being shown. And that's just how it is.
I think we're very much men of our time. You know, there's a lot happening then. And I was struck at how diverse GLF is seen in the pictures, and yet in the beginning there was very little diversity, as Brian points out.
Racial diversity.
Racial diversity. And then a lot of people split off. I mean, there was Black Pride Day was formed, a lot of other...
Right, partially by Theodore Kirkland.
Who was one of the GLF, one of the Skyline faggots. But it was just a very difficult time. We all wanted to work together, but... And that's part of the problem of having no organization, too. You can make these pronouncements, but there's no organizing factor to do anything. So I think we probably, and maybe because of shame, probably just went, oh.
Yeah. Goodwill
yikes.
Is not enough.
And then we're on to other things.
I just wanted to ask Nancy about the church. You mentioned there was a church on Capitol Hill where Frank Kameny would take you all to meet and be behind the conference room. Which church was it?
You know, I've been trying to remember that. It was right behind the library.
St. Mark's.
St. Mark's on Capitol Hill.
I just mentioned that because the National Park Service is starting an initiative to focus on LGBT historic sites.
Right.
Between the meetings. Tuesday, everybody's welcome to come to a public session at the Department of the Interior starting at 2 p.m.
I would love to know if that room still exists. There was also Managing had an office on F Street in one of what was then, you know, a kind of a ratty office building. But it had a two-room office on F Street as well.
GLF also hosted the first public gay dance in D.C. at St. Mark's Church as well.
Yeah.
Jose?
Is it diversity, transvestite, or transgender people involved or doing shows in that time? Do you remember?
The question was whether there were transgender people involved in, or transvestite people involved in GLFDC.
Not that I know of, seriously transgender or seriously transvestite. There was a lot of bits and pieces of cross-gender dressing, but I don't know, maybe other people know. I don't think there were transgender.
I remember nobody, but you know, that could be people were disguising themselves at that point, and there certainly wasn't the level of consciousness back then about trans issues as there is now. But I think the closest that GLF got to was the skag drag.
Jose? Remember, there was a drag queen named Jose that was there a lot. Was that Senorita Cosa?
He didn't dress as drag.
He did. Was Jose Ramos? That's probably.
Yeah. It might have been. I don't know.
I know he turned drags in drag.
Yeah, but that was part of the drag queen community.
Well, that's transvestite.
I know the Skyline Faggots. I don't know where we met her, but we did have this drag queen come to our house to teach us self-defense. So don't even think you can fool. But yeah, I think there just wasn't that kind of consciousness around then. And again, considering how many drag queens were involved with Stonewall, it was amazing how quickly they kind of disappeared from the scene. There was a group in New York. What was it called? Do you remember?
The Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries?
Right, Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries. So we met people from that group, but they weren't with GLO.
Eva.
Well, I was just wondering what, if anyone on the panel has any thoughts on what it might take today to jar the community out of its complacency.
I'll mention as an addendum to that question, again from Warren Blumenfeld, he talks about the four M's of the modern gay movement, which are marriage equality, military service, media visibility, and making money. Is there anything else? Is there a way to sort of turn the tide and make things more...
Maybe you have an idea. I don't.
I think issues like this, issues like ours are cyclical. And there doesn't seem to be the stomach in the country now for revolution of any kind. You know, many groups work on their issues, whether it's reproductive rights issues or it's ethnic issues or whatever. But what happened in the late 60s and early 70s was a volcano. And what we've got now is just little tiny bubbles here and there.
In a swamp.
And I go back again to my earlier point about the economy. When you're focused on putting bread on the table, you don't have an awful lot of time or energy to think about how you're being oppressed, whatever you define your oppression as. And I think that with time, as the economy slides down, as the country gets, I'll call it tighter, we're here to here. At here is where people revolt, where union movements get fed up, where ethnic and gender movements get fed up. And we are not anywhere near that point now. We still are plugging along. We can still do it we are not yet fed up. At some point in the future, we or our heirs will be fed up again, and there will be more of those revolts. But I think we are far from it right now. I give it 20, 30, 40 years even.
Right there.
Hi, my name is Derek. Thank you so much for your words. My question is, if you all could explain a little your connection, if any, to the later ACT UP movement, to maybe talk a little about what the ACT UP is organizing, how that may have been inspired by, or how it was different from the Gay Liberation Front, and maybe what you all learned individually about gay organizing after AIDS.
Great question. I'll talk for myself. I sort of left gay activities when I left Washington, D.C. in 1992. But what I saw, I remember reading in The Blade, when I was no longer associated with The Blade, that a woman that I had known as a lesbian feminist separatist was working with an AIDS organization. And I thought to myself when I saw her name associated with this AIDS group that hallelujah, the separation between lesbians and gay men was coming back together again, that we were going to talk with gay men again, we were going to work with gay men again, we were going to be in community with gay men again. I never was involved in ACT UP or any of the AIDS organizations, but I observed that I think the freedom that we have today is a result more of AIDS and the reaction to AIDS than it was to any Gay Liberation Front or Gay Activist Alliance or Mattachine Society. They laid the groundwork. But when people began dying and talking about dying and involving their families and their friends in their dying and in their cures for dying, that's when we became human to everybody. That's what I believe.
Yeah, that's true. I agree. That's a good point, because but it did come from Mattachine, GLF. I mean,
right? They laid the ground.
The Gay Liberation Front, you know, sort of paved the word for ACT, paved the road for ACT UP, because ACT UP was not a civil rights organization. They didn't petition. I mean, they acted up, and that was what Gay Liberation was about. I think. I think they were the next stage. But I think the AIDS epidemic did do a lot of change in the world as far as, you know, as we're concerned. Joel?
Well, I'd like to go back a little bit and just say that, you know, the times were very different in the late 60s and the 70s. People were not out. You know, we always used to wonder, was there a gay congressman? Today, we don't wonder about these things, we know. There are so many things that we were hidden. We as gay people, most of us were hidden. And so there were so many avenues that were really basically shut off from us. And all these organizations were progressions. You know, the Mattachine Society, the GLF, the GAA, all these religious groups, Bet Mishpacha, all these things. And ACT UP was a natural progression because there was a need to demonstrate and prove that we have to do something. And each time there is a need to prove something, we do it. Now we have marriage equality also, which in my mind is not so important, but it somehow evolved into that, and that's where our focus is, and who knows what the next evolution revolution may be in this movement.
I think that also ACT UP was by necessity a single issue, and that seems to be the way activism is going now. Everything's a single issue, and these links and connections don't quite get made. Also, you also see what's happened with AIDS activism, where it also got pretty much co-opted by the pharmaceutical companies. And now you have a lot of activists that are promoting, I always forget the initial, it's the pre-exposure drug. And now they're actually talking about making sure that more and more young men, primarily, are taking this drug, which a lot of scientists would say is going to really create a much stronger virus because they're not going to be able to follow the compliance. that you can't follow to make sure somebody's taking it every day. And so now it's shifted where the whole focus is making sure that the pharmaceuticals are making money. And it is going to save lives, no doubt about it, but it's a pretty controversial thing. And it's really being driven by the pharmaceutical companies.
Yes, no?
There are some problems with PrEP, but no, it's not being run by the pharmaceuticals. It's being run very much by our community trying to save lives. And we do have to have some good discussions and some good education on it. But I was also fascinated, you know, right now, if you look at the LGBT organizations, they work together. They are going after the same dollar. So there is some competition. There's more collaboration than perhaps what we heard. There are more links with other groups in civil rights, in human rights. One of the big groups right now is internationally and seeing what we can do for our brothers and sisters in other countries who may be back where we were in the 50s and 60s and being terrorized by their governments. So we see that as a big issue. The one here that's, you know, sort of the cutting edge issue is trans rights and what is the right way to deal with that. I mean, and we don't know. So we're getting the same sort of, you know, should it be transgressive? Should it be as, you know, accommodating as possible, and how do you do that education? So those debates are going on in the community strongly, differently than in the 60s, because it's a different time now, we still have those who want to organize loud and fast, and those who want to organize behind the scenes and collaborate across the board. But I would say that too, you know, movement issues right now are international and trans rights.
Although certain of our major gay rights groups have shown the willingness to toss transgender people out when it comes to something like the passage of the Employment Non-Discrimination Act. Last time that was close to being passed, so I wonder...
Hooray for Chelsea Manning.
Our hero. And the artist.
But that was 10 years ago, and at what point do you get, you know, is there enough time to say, everyone said that they made a mistake then. We've gone 10 years, and it is now inclusive, but what we've added is this hideous religious exemption. So if there's anything we should be personally, if you wonder what I think we should be liberating ourselves from, it's religion.
Pete?
I was struck with how much the notion of the GLF that you described was really about the need to do internal freedom, freedom from our own internal pressure, so that we can do the work of the world. And I'm wondering, to me, that seems like it's maybe one of the biggest differences now, is that now there are millions of high school kids who are coming up in high schools that have GSA groups, thousands of them. And there are a lot of people growing up in churches that are marrying gay people, that have gay clergy. And so I wonder how different the sense is, how many people are not growing up in the same stew of cultural oppression that some of us are.
I think that kind of oppression is still localized.
Sure.
You know, I mean, if you grow up in the church, you know, even in an evangelical church or a conservative church, you're going to find, gee whiz, it's like the 50s again or the early 60s. I'm agog when I see that there are kids that are going to their proms, you know, as gay couples, as same-sex couples. I don't know, I can't pick up a newspaper these days without my mouth dropping open at what is going on with us, things that we never dreamed of being able to have happen. to flip on the TV and see all kinds of gay characters, a gay channel for crying out loud. And I had to sneak down into my parents' basement to turn on the TV very quietly to see real homosexuals being interviewed after 11 o'clock at night on television.
I still work with clients that have gone through reparative therapies. That's still happening, and it's absolutely true. But I think on one hand, the better things get, the reaction becomes more severe. And a good example is that gay bashing, which I've done a lot of work on since being bashed, have actually gone down in number, but the severity has gone up, and it's more likely to end in death. I mean, it's always back and forth. But I just have to tell you an amusing anecdote. I got a client about 10 years ago that came into my office, and I said, well, so, what do you want to happen? What do you want to change? And he said, if my parents come to one more gay pride march with me, I'm just going to scream. I have got to get them off my back.
Were they finding him a husband, too?
They were looking, yeah. And I actually excused myself and went into the bathroom and went, good God!
I have been told or received people pointing at the watches to let me know that we are pretty much out of time at this point. I know that all of our panelists are still going to be here, and I'm certainly willing to take individual questions. We at the Rainbow History Project just wanted to give each of them a small token of our esteem and thanks for coming here at their own expense. Just to wrap up, the chair of the Rainbow History Project, Chuck Goldfarb, is just going to say a couple of words, if you could give attention to Chuck. Well, thanks again to all of you.
Very briefly, this has been a great event. Rainbow History Project needs all of you. And we need you in many ways. One, we need your oral histories. It is important. We're hoping we'll be able to get the oral histories of the members of the panel, but all of you. We're here now and we can talk about it. 20 years, we may be very few of us here. We need your stories, because your stories will allow researchers 20 years from now, 30 years from now, when times may be worse for the LGBT community, to know what was really going on. So we ask you to give us your stories. We will be happy to come and meet with you and have you, just on tape tell us your stories. We need that. We also, now that we are partnering with the Historical Society of Washington, so there is a library where we're able to keep collections, we also want the documents and other materials you may have stored away in your attic, stored in the garage, getting in the way when you're about to move, don't throw them out, please. Things that you have really, again, will make a difference for researchers. So please help us with that.
Do you have any connection or partnership with this new archive of activism that we read about?
Oh, with the new Mattachine Society of Washington that has reformed. Well,
they are doing some specific narrow research on discrimination as it occurred within the federal government. We are an archive for the DC LGBT community broadly, for all the activities that are going on, not just for federal employment.
Is Charles Francis here, though? I've seen on Facebook he'd said he might come. He is the head of the reconstituted Mattachine Society of Washington. Is Charles here? No, I guess not.
And let me just finally say, there are many of you, happily, I'm so glad to see young people here who don't have things from 40 years ago tucked away in their closet, but we can use your help as we get collections in. We can get together and have a great time just processing things. We also need to know what are the important issues that you, not just those of us who are in our 60s and are being nostalgic, but some of the younger people, what you think we should be collecting. Help us be part of this. Please contact us. If you haven't signed in when this began, we still have the sign-up sheets. Please give us your name and your email address. And we will be continuing with other programs. We have some programs that are in early stages. We, as many of you probably know, we've had attempts at a gay community center going back to the mid-70s when there's an attempt at a gay community services center that actually some GLF and the old Gay Men's Counseling Collective and the old Gay Men's VD Clinic all started to get started. Then, you know, there were attempts again in the 80s and 90s. We're hoping, and of course now the center that David Mariner is doing such a great job with, we want to have a program on that. We want to have a program on the charitable giving within our community. We talked earlier about the dependence on money. Brother Help Thyself probably has done more to keep institutions, to help startup institutions in our community.
Including the Rainbow History Project, very much the Rainbow History Project. Yes, thank you.
We plan to have a program on that. There are lots of programs we can do, but we need your help, so please join us. Thank you.
What Chuck has not mentioned, we do have membership forms in the back as well. If anybody would like to join the Rainbow History Project, give us some money to continue the programs that are being pursued. And also, if you have a chance today or throughout the month of June, there are two display cases straight across on the other side in the Kiplinger Research Library, which is the exhibition of materials related to Gay Liberation Front DC and related to many of the events and activities that our panelists discussed today. Vince?
And if I can add one more thing, too. We talked about a couple different places today. They mentioned the Department of National Park Services Initiative. We have on our website now our Places and Spaces database. Has over 450 places of historical significance to our community here within Washington, D.C. Joanna, if you could stand up, maybe. our intern from American University, and she's the one who was able to plot it all out, get it all in a Google map. So thank you, Joanna.
Thank you.